First, exercise your right to vote. People die for that right. Take it seriously. Don't stay home. Honor those who have fought for this right to vote. And secondly, take a close look at the issues in this election. Boy, there is a stark contrast between candidates, including my race with Mr. Oberweis here. I think what's at stake here is the future of the middle class in our country, in our state, and working families need some help. The best way they can get help is for us in Washington to focus on the basics. Let's make sure that we increase the minimum wage so that people who get up and go to work every single day are treated with dignity and paid with enough money that they can get by. Secondly, let's help pay for your kids' college education. I'm for renegotiating these college student loans to lower interest rates so that your son or daughter can go to college and not end up with a mountain of debt that they can't take care of in a short period of time. I also want to make sure that whether you're rich or poor in America, you have access to quality health insurance. Too many Americans before the passage of the Affordable Care Act just had no access at all. So I think those three basics, a job, education for you and your children, and making sure that you have health care are essential in this election. And it's a stark contrast between us. My opponent opposes raising the minimum wage. I don't know that he's taken a position at all on renegotiating college student loans. He's voted against student aid when he was a state senator in Springfield. And finally, when it comes to the issue of health insurance, he wants to repeal the Affordable Care Act. It might mean, incidentally, that when your son or daughter graduates from college, they won't have health insurance because he'd have his way and repeal it.
Thank you, sir. I would say that my opponent, Mr. Durbin, has been in Washington now for 32 years. That's too long. I believe that when you have career politicians, there's too much of a tendency for them to want to vote in ways that will help them get reelected. I believe that when you have citizen legislators like myself, and like the framers of our Constitution believed in, you have people who are going to be interested in voting in ways that they believe are good for our country and good for our state, as opposed to good for re-election. I think 32 years is too long for anyone to serve. When we also look at the economics and how have poor and middle class families been served, just since the last time my opponent ran for re-election 6 years ago, the average income of an Illinois family has declined by $5,053. It's time for a change.
Senator Durbin, one of the criticisms of Washington consistently is the paralysis and the inability to move legislation, even bipartisan legislation. How do you defend Harry Reid's responsibility to not move bipartisan bills? I think there are 352 bills that have been at the Senate that was fact-checked by a bipartisan organization. Mm-hmm. Many of those would help jobs, veterans, and some people say Harry Reid has taken this blockage farther than any other leader in the past to protect your members. How do you defend that?
We're facing something we've never seen before in the Senate. The incidence of filibusters by the Republicans has broken all records. It used to be there were two or three a year 50 years ago. Now there are over 135 filibusters every year. It slows the Senate to a crawl and brings it to a stop as the Republicans demand 60 votes on measure after measure after measure. Occasionally we break through. The bipartisan comprehensive immigration reform bill is a good example. I worked on that last year. I sat across the table from my friend and colleague John McCain. We had real serious differences. But eight senators, four Democrats and four Republicans, created a bill that passed the Senate with 68 votes. We sent it to the House of Representatives, controlled by Speaker Boehner. He never called it for a year and a half, never called the legislation. When we sent him a farm bill 3 years ago, it took him 3 years to finally pass a bipartisan farm bill. The Marketplace Fairness Bill, maybe the single most important bill for small businesses and retailers in our state and around our nation, I passed that with a bipartisan roll call. It was a bipartisan bill over a year and a half ago, never been called by Speaker Boehner. I think that's troubling. I think he has an obligation, should have, as we do too, to consider bipartisan legislation. Most of the things he sent us, whether it's 50 votes to repeal the Affordable Care Act or whatever it is, tend to be entirely two-partisan and not bipartisan.
And the same criticism can be leveled at your leadership?
Well, certainly there are bills that we could call if we could reach an agreement on the floor, and I hope we do. But the point is, we've sent him bipartisan legislation, significant legislation that the president supports, and he waits a year and a half and never calls the measure, even for debate on the floor of the House of Representatives.
But we're talking about your, I understand that, but if you look at even the the ratio of bills. The House has called more bills. I think they're waiting on or sitting on maybe 50 bills that the Senate has passed. So how do you get to 350 substantive bipartisan bills?
Well, you see, you slipped in the word bipartisan, and that is significant. If you look at the bills sent to us by Speaker Boehner over and over and over again, they are basically press releases. They really don't address the key issues facing our country, issues as basic as whether or not we're going to deal with our broken immigration system. You know, we put a lot of time into that. That was 6 months of negotiation.
We're on board with you on that. I'm questioning a bill they sent that would have given the VA director more authority to fire seniors.
Well, we passed that. No, we did pass that. You see, that's an example. They would send us an individual bill. When we had the VA crisis just a few weeks ago, we passed a bipartisan bill, and it included that.
And how can you expect to reach some kind of bipartisanship after this election if you and Senate Democrats aren't willing to accept any responsibility as part of the party?
Oh, no, I accept that, Bruce. I mean, I do. And I think that we can do better. And I've worked on the Simpson-Bowles Commission with Republican senators. The measures I've talked about are all bipartisan measures. Lamar Alexander, Michael Enzi, both Republican senators. We are working now so that when we get back in session, we can bring a bill to the floor for consideration. I think that's a key to it. It may not be a top-down solution. It's a bottom-up solution. Individual senators working together. Give you an example. Two of the most unlikely allies, Joe Manchin of West Virginia and Patrick Toomey of Pennsylvania, after the terrible, horrible shooting in Connecticut, came forward with bipartisan legislation, Manchin-Toomey, for universal background checks, so that we keep guns out of the hands of violent criminals and guns out of the hands of people who are mentally unstable. That was a bipartisan bill. We passed it. It went nowhere in the House of Representatives. Incidentally, my opponent opposes universal background checks. That's why he just got the endorsement of the NRA. But most people, 92%, and your editorial board, think universal background checks. We had a bipartisan bill from two conservative members, and the House wouldn't even call it.
How would you break the logjam?
Well, I would say I have been very successful in Springfield with working with the other side. I would take the example of Ronald Reagan and Tip O'Neill, who obviously had very, very different political philosophies, yet they managed to work together as gentlemen to help solve legislation. In Springfield, I worked with Senator Marty Sandoval, who probably is quite distant from me in some political philosophies. But we've actually become friends, and we're known around Springfield as the odd couple because we have been able to work together to solve legislative problems. I don't believe that we have to be nasty. I don't believe that we have to be totally partisan, as Senator Durbin has been on so many instances. I believe that I will look at legislation, try to come up with the best solutions that we can, listen to the other side, and try to incorporate that and come up with bipartisan solutions.
It's hard to gauge your level of bipartisanship in Springfield because you were there for such a short time before you announced you wanted a different seat. We've talked about this before, the perennial run for office. Again, why jump so quickly into another race before you fulfilled an obligation to fill a Senate term?
Bruce, I've been there for 2 years in Springfield. It doesn't take 2 years to learn your way around Springfield, as some people would argue. It does take a few months. There is a learning process, no question about it. It is difficult to get things done in Springfield when you're in the vast minority, 19 out of 59, obviously. But I have worked with the other side. We did get legislation passed that had been defeated 4 times in a row to increase speed limit on interstates in Illinois. The reason that I ran for this was that a number of people asked me to do so, because as the senator said himself, this is a very, very important election. It will help change the direction of our country. I believe we need more balance in Springfield, which a Republican governor would bring to balance the Democrat legislature. I believe that if I'm elected to this Senate seat, it's very likely Republicans will take control of the Senate. So you then have a Republican legislator and a Democrat president, again, giving some balance. It would allow, I think, that logjam of legislation to be moved forward, to be discussed, voted on, and hopefully more of it passed. Then the president could make a decision whether he agrees with it, likes it, or chooses to veto it.
It also might mean that Republicans would sit down with the president, listen to his point of view, and try to incorporate that in the bill. And the president, on the other hand, would have to listen to what Congress is saying.
Senator Durbin, the Senate is not going to vote on whether to authorize what the president is doing in Iraq and Syria until after the election. Isn't time to vote on war and peace before we go to war?
Well, the War Powers Act allows the president to take action, notify Congress, and after a period of time, Congress then has a responsibility, I believe under the Constitution and under that statute, to respond. Here's the state of play as I see it. There was a vote as to whether or not the president could train and equip the Free Syrian Army, in this case, to fight the Islamic State in Syria. That vote was overwhelming. 3/4 of the members of the House and Senate supported it. I supported it. And it gave the president the authority to work with them. He believes, and I think it is arguable, that the original authorization for the invasion of Iraq covers what we're doing there to fight the Islamic State. I feel, and others share this feeling on both sides of the aisle, that it's time for us to revisit what they call the authorization for use of military force. It is 10, 12 years old, depending on which one you refer to. And it's time for us to put it in the context of modern day. It was a kind of a broad mandate to a president to protect us from Al-Qaeda and its associates responsible for 9/11. What we're facing today, it's a stretch to connect up the dots to Al-Qaeda, but the threats are just as real. So we'll be returning, and I'm a member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, and the first thing we'll take up in November is this reauthorization of the use of military force. Before the end of the year, I want to vote. I want to vote by Congress before we go further. This will not be over, I'm sad to say, by the end of the year. So we ought to speak and make the decision as we're required by the Constitution to give the president or not give the president the authority to move forward.
Senator Oberweis, do you?
Can I just ask, Senator, did you say that it's a stretch to connect Khorasan or ISIS to Al-Qaeda?
What the bill says, the authorization use of military force connects extremism to the Al-Qaeda extreme group, which we know well was responsible for 9/11. We know there's a connection there, but what I'm saying is there are other threats to America beyond Al-Qaeda, and every president ought to have the authority to protect us from those threats wherever they come from. And so what I'm saying is we need an authorization for the use of military force that defines it in broader terms. Islamic State is just as dangerous, if not more so, than Al-Qaeda in terms of its potential. But the language was written to go after those responsible for 9/11. The threat, sadly, is much broader today.
Would you support Senator Kaine's bill, which has a very short sunset, 1 year, I think,
yes.
18 months, something
yes,
like that?
Yes, and I've worked with Tim on this. He sent me a copy of that bill. I think it is, I don't know if year is right. I think it is appropriate for us to sunset this authority, revisit this authority. Things tend to change and evolve, and we ought to be mindful of our responsibility to watch carefully. I agree with the president's premise, and he said it over and over, that we should not send ground troops into this situation. We have tried that. That's what Al-Qaeda hopes we'll do, is bog down in that kind of a combat situation. But revisiting this on a periodic basis, whether it's 1 year or 2 years, I think is good policy.
Senator Oberweis, do you think undertook this military operation, and do you think he should have done it without congressional authorization?
Well, I think the limited bombings that were done, I would agree with the senator on, I believe, is authorized, is allowable, and we know this is a very serious threat, so I do think that bringing it to Congress to get further authorization going forward does make a lot of sense, but I do believe he had the authority to do that.
Do you think will the U.S. eventually have to use ground troops? Do you think that the White House and the senator should be ruling that out as an option?
I absolutely do not think they should rule it out as an option. I don't think we should tell our enemies what we're going to do. Let them figure it out. Let them guess. Let them worry about it. I don't know if we'll end up having to use ground troops, but it seems to me that we want to pay attention to what our experts, what our generals are telling us. And certainly some of them at least are saying that that may in fact be the case. Now, is it possible that it could be ground troops from Saudi Arabia, from other countries? That's possible.
But it is likely that if we're going to eventually win this, there are going to be some ground troops involved.
Senator, if this mission is critical, as everyone seems to say, why would you rule out any option?
My theory is this war started with the deposition of the Shah of Iran. That, to me, was the launch of radical, extreme Islam that has manifested itself in countries all over the world with various groups flying that flag. And we are in for a long haul. We learned the hard way. When we went in Afghanistan, it turned out we were going after the Al-Qaeda forces responsible for 9/11. It turned out to be the longest war in the history of the United States. None of us knew that at the time when we were voting to go after the perpetrators of 9/11. Here's what we know. When we send ground troops into the Middle East, they are easily bogged down and mired down. When I went to Walter Reed Hospital and saw the first casualty that I can remember from the Iraq War, he was a member of the National Guard from Ohio. He was in the most sophisticated equipment, well-trained, and he ended up being the victim of a roadside bomb and losing his leg. And I thought to myself, if a crude weapon like that can stop a military power like the United States, we ought to think twice. And so what I'd say is this. If we are going to have a role in the Middle East, I think the president is properly defining it. We will use the Iraqi army, 900,000 strong, train them, direct them, support them with air and logistics and intelligence. But the Iraqis have to be willing to fight for Iraq. We're not going to send American soldiers in there to be bogged down in another long war. At the end of the Iraqi war, we lost 4,476 Americans. 30,000 came home with serious injuries. We added $1 trillion to our national debt, and the country was still in chaos. It has to be driven by the forces in the Middle East. Last point I'll make, the president's international coalition, which includes major Arab Muslim countries, is the right move. They have to care about stability and peace in the Middle East, and we shouldn't be sending America's brave men and women in there to die without their commitment.
Yeah, I'm sorry, contrary to what you just said, didn't our president say that in fact Iraq was no longer in chaos, that Iraq had been, things had been accomplished, and we'd made great strides, and that was why we could pull all of our troops out at that point? And this was just, what, a year or two ago?
What the president said to the Iraqis, at some point, you have to accept the responsibility here. We're not going to make this a permanent...
He said that everything is fine now, that we had accomplished missions.
He never went that far, and when we tried to keep some forces on the ground, the Iraqi government under Maliki would not agree. We said the basic rule is here, if we're going to leave American forces in here, they're not going to be dragged into Iraqi courts to be tried for their actions. And the Iraqi government would not agree, the Afghan government would not agree, and it was President George W. Bush that negotiated the end date in Iraq.
Could you have kept troops in without a status of forces agreement?
Yes.
Think about that. What he's just said is we would have left American soldiers on the ground in these countries subject to be tried for crimes in the courts of that country if they executed their military duties. President Bush thought that was a bad idea. President Obama thought that was a bad idea. Most Americans think it was a bad idea, except for my opponent.
I think it was a bad idea to withdraw all of our troops and let this country fall the way it has fallen. I believe that we could have negotiated an agreement that would have been acceptable, that would not necessarily have allowed troops to be subject to Iraqi courts, and I believe that we didn't do a satisfactory job in getting that agreement, but we should have.
How many troops do you think we should have left there, and for how long?
As a guess, 10,000 would have been, I think, a reasonable number. Certainly 5,000 to 10,000 would have been making a commitment. For how long? I don't know how long. We've had troops, obviously, in Germany. We've had troops in South Korea. They've become major station points for our troops. Now, I don't want to leave troops there unless it provides a military advantage to do so.
Gentlemen, Senator and Senator, two questions in the realm of ethics. Senator Durbin, on the day of Rod Blagojevich's arrest, you urged Illinois lawmakers to quickly enable a special election to fill President-elect Obama's Senate seat. You said no appointment by the governor could produce a credible replacement. But Illinois voters played no role in the seating of Roland Burris. Today, would you just as vocally advocate for Illinois elections to fill any future U.S. Senate vacancies?
I believed at the time, and still do, that there was such a blow to the body politic in Illinois by the arrest of a sitting governor being led from his home in handcuffs, that in order to have a credible replacement, that the people needed to speak. I got a phone call from Roland Burris, shortly thereafter, and he started talking to me about possibilities. And at the end of the phone call, I said, are you talking about being appointed by Governor Blagojevich? And he said, well, that may have, I said, don't do that. You don't want to be associated with him at this moment in history and after your service in public office. It was such a dangerous time in terms of the credibility with the public and the involvement of the public that I felt an election would be the right way to let the people speak about a successor. In terms, now, I think the law is really in doubt. As I understand it, and I may be wrong here, I hope I'm saying this accurately. As I understand it, there is a statutory method or procedure for filling such a vacancy until the next election. But the courts, at least one court in Illinois, has ruled that that doesn't stand, that there should be a special election. So the current situation is in doubt.
I'm just asking, where are you? Special election or not?
I think in that case, a special election was warranted. As to what the... Okay, let me just say flat out, I think a special election is the right way to do it.
Thank you. Senator Oberweis.
To be honest with you, I haven't thought seriously about that issue. Certainly my first reaction is a special election would certainly make sense, but I'd like to really understand the arguments on both sides before I commit.
That's fine. Back to Senator Durbin, if I may. On several fronts, we have lipstick cesses as a recurring theme. First, the effort to amend the Bill of Rights provision on free speech. What we labeled your effort to build an enemies list of private ALEC donors. The letter urging the IRS commissioner to examine one conservative advocacy group in particular by name, then saying when the scandal broke that, quote, it's absolutely unacceptable to single out any political group and target them. It's unthinkable, Nixonian. Senator, you speak often about the danger of money in politics, yet it's your party's Senate campaign committee that's outspending the Republicans by $30 million or so dollars thus far.
Mr. McCormick.
So is the problem campaign money or money in the hands of people who disagree with you?
Mr. McCormick, John, that analysis is not even close.
Okay.
Right now, I'll just give you an example.
No,
Koch brothers. In the last election cycle, the Koch brothers spent over $250 million. They're a bigger force than the Democratic Senate Campaign Committee, the Democratic Congressional Campaign, the Democratic National Committee. What we've done with Citizens United is throw the door open wide. There's a businessman in the suburbs of Chicago whom I've never met who has personally spent $700,000 in negative advertising against me, his money. How could he do this? Under the old rules, he couldn't, but under Citizens United, and the interpretations of the Supreme Court, they've thrown the doors open. They said, we're going to treat corporations like they're human beings. I'll believe that the first time they send a corporation to prison for embezzlement. But that hasn't happened. What we're seeing with the Citizens United decision is, frankly, we've taken away from ordinary Americans and ordinary citizens the role they traditionally played. Look at the governor's race here. I don't know what the ultimate amount, but it will probably break all records in spending. I think they're in the range of 40 million now and talking about millions more. I don't think it's healthy. And I think it's going to discourage mere mortals from getting into politics when they see that they're up against big money. ALEC, let's talk about that for a minute. It amazes me that the Chicago Tribune Editorial Board believes in secrecy when it comes to government. Secrecy. What is ALEC? ALEC is a group that comes up with model legislation that they propose to legislatures. Who sponsors and finances ALEC? No disclosure, it's secret. They tripped up once and left a list of 300 corporations that support them. What kind of measures are they pushing for across America? Stand your ground, one of their provisions. You say, why would corporations be interested in stand your ground laws? Turns out ALEC was pushing them in states. They were also interested in voter suppression, voter IDs, shortening the period of time people can vote in advance of elections. Since when did that become a corporate strategy to limit the rights of people to vote? So I had a hearing on Stand Your Ground, and I wrote to what was purportedly a group of supporters of ALEC and said, what do you think of Stand Your Ground? One corporation wrote back and said, we support it. The rest of them said, we're opposed to it. Now, this is usually fodder for most editorial boards to say, let's look into this organization. Let's find out who's behind this organization, if they have such a profound impact on American politics, whether it's right or left. Finally, my opponent happens to think the biggest single issue in this campaign is defending Karl Rove. I don't think it is. I wrote to the IRS 4 years ago and released the letter publicly, nothing to hide, and said, I think the way you're interpreting the law in terms of the secrecy of campaign contributions is flat out wrong. I said, look into all groups, and I named, it's true, I did name Karl Rove and Crossroads. Why did I name them? They were the biggest, and they were the most active. But I said in the letter, and you can read it there, look at all the groups, right and left. And I think they should have, because I think their ruling was just plain wrong, and it gave secrecy to campaign contributions at a time when most editorial boards support full disclosure.
Could you explain how the ALEC situation is different from organized labor passing out template legislation, and we don't know who the specific...
You really don't know who organized labor is?
Well, I'm just saying, you don't have to disclose who your members are as a member of organized labor.
Well,
or
wait,
secondly,
that,
do you not think any Democrats are using 501c4s
they are
in
now.
The same way?
They are now, and I think it ought to stop on both sides. But, you know, here's the difference. If I asked the corporate supporters of ALEC to give us the names of all their stockholders, ridiculous. But I think it's responsible to say, what corporation is supporting the organization that is lobbying for the passage of Stand Your Ground laws in Florida and beyond? Why is that such an outlandish request?
Senator, a chance to respond.
Look, Senator Durbin's gone through so many things, it's hard to go back and catch up on all those. But George Soros has spent large sums of money on the other side of the coin. So to pick out Koch brothers is certainly unfair. This is a clear case of intimidation. In the case of ALEC, for heaven's sakes, as you pointed out, they don't generally support Stand Your Ground. The people involved don't support Stand Your Ground. Well, I'm sure people who've supported you have found that you voted for something that they didn't support as well. So that's not the issue. The issue is, here's an organization that is attempting to provide model legislation that different states can look at and see what's worked in other states. I think that's a very worthy goal. To pick out one particular issue, to Stand Your Ground, and to try to make political points with that against the organization, which is generally conservative-leaning, is, I think, totally unfair. And to subtly try to get those corporations involved and connect them with Stand Your Ground and say, send us your letter, send us your response, and we're going to make those letters public. That's a perfect case of intimidation. Certainly the use of the IRS to intimidate political opponents was wrong when Richard Nixon thought about doing it, and it's wrong when you do it, Senator Durbin. That has to stop, and if I go to Washington, I'll do everything I can to get a special prosecutor named to investigate exactly what was going on and to stop that from continuing in the future.
I favor full disclosure of those who contribute to political candidates and campaigns. Full disclosure. Do you?
Of people that contribute to candidates?
Yes.
Of course, and it's required by law.
No. See, with Citizens United and with the case that we wrote to the IRS about, they are able to collect this money in secret. They get a tax-exempt status while they do it. Now, that to me is unacceptable. I think full disclosure is the only way voters know who's paying for these ads on television.
First of all,
can I just clarify with the Senator for a second? You're talking about 501c4s at this point.
Yes.
But what you're also doing is equating a 501c4 collecting money with money going to candidates. I believe for candidates was your phrase.
Right.
Is that correct?
Right.
So you see a 501c4 as a candidate-oriented organization.
Of course, John. Get real. These ads that they're buying are not for the good of the body politic. They are in favor of a political party, a political candidate, and that's what it's all about. I think full disclosure, I've been the sponsor of an ill-fated piece of legislation called Fair Elections Now for public financing, which would reduce the time of election campaigns, would make public the contributions in these campaigns, and would provide a matching source of funds so that individuals who aren't rich can consider getting in public life. I think that's healthy for America and its political future. The current situation with Citizens United is out of control. Right and left, massive amounts of money coming in. And it really is not. I don't think it's a good thing to do. I'm for full disclosure.
I believe that citizens should be able to fully express their opinions on different issues. And it's my understanding that 501c4s, a majority of the funds, must be used for issue as opposed to individual candidates. And I think that's a reasonable law. The problem is, when you have career politicians like Senator Durbin, who've been in Washington for 32 years, they have incredible, but I found out just in 2 years in being the Illinois Senate, what a phenomenal advantage I have over anybody competing with us. Because I get credit for what my staff does. My staff solves problems for people. guess who gets credit? It should be the staff who does it, but I get credit. In the news all the time, because I'm invited to events that happen in my district. The same thing happens in the U.S. Senate and Congress. Incumbents have an incredible advantage. I believe something like 92 or 94% of incumbents who run for re-election get re-elected. And it isn't always because they did a great job. It's because people recognize the name. They have a huge advantage. If you stop the free will of people, if you stop the ability for people to support candidates that they believe in, who wins? The answer is incumbents. Naturally, incumbents, career politicians of 32 years are going to support that.
I think if I sold ice cream, people would recognize my name more, too.
If I could bring up a different subject, could you explain why you oppose universal background checks for gun sales? Are there any new restrictions on gun sales or ownership that you would favor at the federal level?
Let me say, first of all, I was one of the sponsors of the bill that passed in Springfield for concealed carry. Anytime you get the city of Chicago to agree with the NRA on legislation, we need to take a pretty careful look at it. I think that was a great tribute to the people who worked on that, for the people who got that kind of agreement. I believe that Illinois does have some of the most restrictive gun laws of any
state. I'm asking about federal.
I'm coming. Illinois has some of the most restrictive gun laws, and yet we also have some of the highest crime rates using guns. If I believe that a universal background check would clearly reduce crime, if it would reduce homicides, I would certainly want to take a look at that very carefully. But the evidence is that it hasn't made any difference. Certainly a lot of people are afraid that if we have universal background checks, it creates this database for the federal government. And as we know, we're seeing concerns about that in other areas, cell phone messages, cell phone locations, and so on. People don't believe the government should have access to too much information. That's an area that certainly has some concern. But if I was convinced that it would, in fact, help to reduce crime, I would look at it.
We're sitting in an area where it has been shown, and data has proven, and we've written about it in our news pages, that because Indiana does not have as strict background check policies, the guns are flowing here. I mean, how can you sit in the Midwest, right where this is happening, look at all the illegal gun toters in Chicago and on the South Side, and not support a very moderate background check and closing gun show loophole bill in the Senate?
Well, again, do you believe that if you had some type of universal background check that would stop people from buying guns illegally?
I'm going to start with yes. If we do.
Okay, I'm not convinced of that. And if I were, I might look at it differently.
Superintendent McCarthy told me that in the city of Chicago last year, crime guns confiscated, compared to crime guns confiscated in New York and Los Angeles, we had 6 times the numbers per capita confiscated in Chicago as the city of New York and twice as many as the city of Los Angeles per capita. We are awash in guns. There are several things that need to be done. We need to close the gun loophole. The state that ranks third or fourth in supplying crime guns to Illinois, Mississippi. Why? Because you put a driver's license on the counter in Mississippi and they'll sell you as many guns as you want to put in the trunk of your car. And they bring them up here and peddle them to these crime gangs. I believe that we've got to have good laws that have universal background checks.
So how would a background check change
that? I'll tell you how it changes it. There are two things about it. First, most responsible gun owners and sportsmen are not opposed to keeping guns out of the hands of convicted felons and mentally unstable people. I found that they accept that because they understand these are lethal weapons that can kill innocent people. Secondly, we've got to make sure that the straw purchasing comes to the end. Whether it's Chuck's out in Riverdale or some shop over the border in Indiana, the notion that the girlfriend goes in and buys the gun for the boyfriend to go out and kill somebody tonight, I want to stiffen the penalty on that. I have no idea where my opponent is on that. Also, gun tracing. What we've done is our own effort encouraging police departments across Illinois to trace guns. What difference does it make? You find the crime gun in Chicago, you trace it to a murder in East St. Louis. I'm not making this up. The Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Division, I went into their office here, they're connecting up the solution of crimes by going after gun tracing. Now that scares some people on the far right who think, oh my goodness, the government's looking at our guns very closely. But the legitimate, honest, responsible owners of weapons accept this. They don't want any more gun violence. My opponent clearly is in a minority of 8% of Americans who say the government shouldn't do more.
Well, you saw the terrible tragedy in Newtown. Did that cause you to in any way rethink your position on access to guns?
It certainly did make me think about it. In fact, I met with the, in Springfield, met with the parents of some of the people that were involved. It's a tragic situation. We certainly want to do whatever we can. But my concern is I want to understand what will actually work, what isn't just one more attempt, one more regulation that isn't going to be effective. Perhaps strengthening penalties for straw man purchases would make sense. I don't know. But if it does, I would be willing to support that. But everything the senator is just talking about isn't going to in any way, and neither universal background checks, going to stop straw man purchases, which is clearly a problem.
Senator Oberweis, where's your primary residence?
3 Buckingham Drive. It's now Sugar Grove. It was Aurora for 30 years. I've been in the same home for 37 years.
So you and your wife have different primary residences?
We do.
And explain how that works to us.
Sure. We bought a condominium in Florida about 4 years ago. She has made that her primary residence and does spend a little more than 6 months a year there.
And how much time do you spend there?
Well, I was planning on spending some time there, but having been elected to the Illinois Senate, I spent only a few weeks there.
Do you think voters can trust that you're actually going to be representing Illinois when your wife and is living more than 6 months of the year in Florida, and that's her primary residence, and that's where she votes? And
Kristen, I have 5 children, 4 of whom live in Illinois. I have 2 stepchildren who both live here in Chicago. I have 19 grandkids, 14 of those live here in Illinois. I've been in the Aurora area of Illinois my entire life. As I said, I've been in the same home for 37 years. My businesses, the business I started, Oberweis Asset Management and the Oberweis Mutual Fund family, are in Illinois. Oberweis Dairy is headquartered in Illinois. I'm about as tied to Illinois as anybody could be.
Senator, having a dual residence yourself, obviously Washington and Springfield, do you find this to make sense?
Let me clarify this. I never moved to Washington. For as long as I've been in Congress, I've been commuting, usually 48 round trips a year, back to Springfield, back to Chicago. About 10 years ago, my wife and I were spending so much time up here in this new responsibility, we said, let's buy a condo. We bought one up by Belmont Lakeshore, been there 10 or 12 years. Our primary residence is Springfield, Illinois. It was when I first entered public service. It is to this day. Now, let me clarify what my opponent has told you, because he told you almost half of the story. Until 2010, Jim Oberweis declared that his permanent residency was in Kane County at the home that he just mentioned in Sugar Grove. In 2010, things changed. As of 2010, his wife declared her primary residence in Florida. He was interviewed by another newspaper, as we say, back in November, saying, what is this all about? And he said, it's about tax advantages in Florida, because we know that they don't have a state income tax, he told the reporter. So here's what's going on. In order for his wife to claim her status in Florida, her residence in Florida, he cannot claim a permanent residence in another state. He has to get out of that business. Gave up his permanent tax residence of Kane County, so that now he is viewed, when it comes to taxes, in some capacities, as being a resident of Florida. This may be the first time in history that you have a state senator who declared his home was Kane County to run for office, but declared his tax home to be in Florida. I've never seen that before. What's the advantage? The advantage is he may not be paying Illinois state income tax. Now, I've challenged him. I brought with myself here today so you could see it. This is something that I think you might, that's not it. That's the other one, isn't it?
Should I let him keep going?
Yeah,
let
I hope
him
you'll
go
let me
down
finish
the
it.
Wrong path?
Let me finish this.
Totally wrong, or
these
should
are my,
I interrupt and give you the truth?
These are my income tax returns. I make them public every year. State, federal, income tax returns plus schedules. I've done it every year since I started hanging around with a fellow named Paul Simon. He refuses to disclose his Illinois state income tax returns. The question obviously is, are you paying Illinois state income tax on your income?
Respond.
The senator has attempted to mislead people again, as he has done on several other instances. What he said is clearly not the case. 3 Buckingham Drive is and has been for 37 years my permanent address. However, he apparently seems to be asking me to violate and break the law, because under the law, if my wife claims a residence in Florida for the homestead exemption, I cannot claim a residence in Illinois as my homestead exemption. The Florida homestead exemption is a larger exemption than the one in Illinois, so I allowed her to claim the exemption. I don't get an exemption, which means I pay more Illinois income taxes than I otherwise would.
Disclose your income tax returns.
So this is absolutely complete nonsense that he's talking about, and never did I ever say to anybody at any time in my life that I'm not an Illinois resident.
Will you disclose your Illinois state?
And I will definitely not do that. You get your chance to ask one question later on, I'll be willing to take that question at that point.
All right, well, I'll ask that question. Will you disclose your income tax returns?
I already have disclosed my federal income tax returns. If it's an important issue, I will provide you the state income tax.
With
Senator,
schedules.
Do you have income in Illinois? Do you pay Illinois state income tax? Do you as an individual pay Illinois?
Absolutely. That's another lie you just threw out there. Of course I do. I pay more than I've ever paid before. I am a great customer of the state of Illinois, and they don't respect that.
Shift gears, please. I'd like to ask you both, senators, about deficits and national debt. Economists say while deficits are slowing down, if changes aren't made by 2040, the U.S. government debt is projected to total more than 110% of GDP. Nearly four of every five federal dollars will be spent on entitlement programs and interest payments. I'd like to know to what extent this keeps you up at night and how you would fix the problem.
Who would you like to
go ahead, Senator?
That is one of the main reasons that I'm running for this U.S. Senate seat. Spending has been absolutely out of control. Since Senator Durbin went to Washington, our national debt has gone from $1 trillion to now approaching $18 trillion. It won't be easy to correct this. It will take some time, but we need to get started. I'm very concerned, and you know, my background really is in the financial services business. I realize that what really affects our economy frequently are the unexpected things that happen. If we know this is what's happening, it gets built in and you get expectations being that. But it's the surprise. And what can happen is all of a sudden something causes complete concern for the markets. Suddenly the U.S. government cannot sell new debt to pay off its old debt at reasonable interest rates. Interest rates start skyrocketing. Suddenly interest rates, which are incredibly low right now at about 2.5% for 10-year debt, suddenly it's 4%, 6%, 8%, and the government has difficulty in rolling over those refinancings. As those interest rates go up, that puts even more pressure on our federal budget, huge costs, and we get into a real downward spiral from an economic standpoint. I believe we need to change direction. I think we need to simplify our tax code, not just throw out one more special lobbyist break. The senator, by the way, has received in excess of $9 million from lobbyists and special interest groups. If you add the senator's campaign account to his net worth, it exceeds my campaign added to my net worth. And this is a problem. He talks about spending on political campaigns. My goodness, here is a man who's got $7, $8, $9 million in a campaign account.
So may I ask you how you would fix the problem that you perceive?
Yes, I think we need to begin to look at every program, begin to bring some of the spending under control, and instead of keeping on adding new programs. Now, as we all know, it's those...
What's the biggest driver? What is the biggest opportunity to reduce spending, including entitlements?
Entitlements,
exactly,
obviously...
Specifically, where would you find... What's your target?
Obamacare is clearly a huge new cost. We really need to pass legislation on a bipartisan basis. We need to have both sides working on that to come up with plans that make sense.
How much could you save from, what would you do? Would you repeal, replace?
I would repeal it and replace it with a health care plan that would be available to more people, do it on a...
And how much savings do you think you would get in federal costs from the change in Obamacare?
I believe that there would be $50 to $100 billion in potential savings. I'd have to go back to look at some of the proposals that have been out there, but this is clearly an increasing cost that's going to get worse as time goes on, not get better.
Drivers, Medicare, and Social Security, how would you change those equations?
One way to do it for Medicare, for instance, would be to coordinate retirement age for Medicare with Social Security, which now for all practical purposes going forward is 67. That would certainly be a significant savings as well. We need to look at these and we need to understand what the costs of these programs are going to be and bring them in line with revenues over a period of time.
We know what the costs are. Are you willing to means test Medicare going forward?
I think that is something that should be certainly considered. I will go to Washington and I'll try to listen to the other side. I'll try to work together with both sides to agree on something that will make sense for all sides. But I think that's something that
let me just make sure I've got it correct. You would favor raising the eligibility age for Medicare to 67?
I don't think that's the only answer, the only solution, but yes, I think that's something that should be considered.
Senator Durbin?
Lots of questions here. I don't know. Where do you want to start? You want to start with the deficit and then get into entitlements? Tell me.
Yes, let's do that. And I think we've added trillions of new debt during your last term. We applauded you for your efforts on the Simpson-Bowles kind of framework, but it didn't get done. You know, where is the failure here? Have we reached the point where we're cheered when the deficit, annual deficit, falls under a trillion?
Let's take two snapshots and then talk about today. Snapshot, the year 2000. It was the end of Bill Clinton's 8 years in office. He left having had four straight years of surpluses, budget surpluses. Hadn't happened in 40 years. 23 million new jobs created in that eight-year period of time. And he said to incoming President George W. Bush, here's next year's budget with $120 billion surplus. And the national debt accumulated over the history of America at that moment in time was $5 trillion. Now fast forward 8 years later. Now George W. Bush is turning over to Barack Obama, the economy and the budget. What was the situation? At that point in time, we projected the deficit for the next year, the deficit, not the surplus, to be $1.2 trillion. $1.2 trillion. We were losing 800,000 jobs a month. Mr. Oberweis's mutual funds had taken a beating in the year 2008. They lost 50 to 60% of their value as President Bush was leaving office, and the national debt was no longer $5 trillion. 8 years later, it was $12 trillion. How did we get into that mess? We had wars we didn't pay for, and we had a president who said the answer to every problem is to cut taxes, particularly on wealthy people. My opponent supported that. He was for tax cuts for wealthy people. It was an upside-down approach that drove us deeply into debt. Now, the president inherits a recession, the second worst in modern memory. He puts together a stimulus package, which includes some tax cuts, safety net, and infrastructure. Where are we today? The deficit that he has inherited has been cut by two-thirds, where at the time he took office, 14% of GDP was coming in as revenue and 24% as outlays. The delta, 10%, equaled about $1.5 trillion deficit a year. Now it's down to 18% in revenue and 21.6% in outlays.
Let's move forward, if we can. We asked the senator about specifically about entitlements. Give us a prescription to deal with this, and what are the prospects short term?
Let me link them. What is the number one driver of the deficit in America? Healthcare cost. 60% of the deficit's driven by healthcare cost. What we have done with the Affordable Care Act is to expand the reach of health insurance to 7 million Americans who otherwise didn't have health insurance, showed up sick, and were a burden on the system and a burden on everybody else with health insurance. What we've seen now for five straight years is a decline in the rise. I'm not saying an overall decline, but a decline in the projected rise in healthcare cost because two things are happening. More people are being covered, and secondly, the providers are thinking under Affordable Care, we've got to find a way to do this that doesn't spend as much money. This last week or the week before, the new administrator of Stroger Hospital came in to see me with Tony Preckwinkle. He said, boy, have things changed here. He said, you know, there was a time when Stroger took every poor person in the region and frankly didn't bill anybody. It was a disaster, financial disaster. Now they're billing folks, they're in regular hospital mode, but now they have to compete. He said, our people who are coming in, even low-income people, are expecting better service, quality service. He said, our people are on their toes. There's competition. So when it comes to entitlements, Bruce, let me get down to specifics. Untouched, unchanged, Social Security makes every payment for 20 years, but then falls off the table, 30% cut. What can we do today that small things that play out like interest rates play out that will give us more solvency in Social Security? There are a lot of things on the table.
A fairly quick answer at this point, so the Senator can respond.
I'll tell you. I'll give you an example. First, we ought to expand the reach of FICA taxes beyond the current limitations. I think we ought to be saying that 90% of earned income is subject to the FICA tax, so that more money is coming in to Social Security. Secondly, my opponent and I happen to qualify for Social Security. We paid into it all our lives. I don't believe that in our income level, we ought to be receiving the same COLA as the person who's struggling to get by.
Where would you set that?
Well, I'm willing to move in as part of the solution to this thing in reducing the COLA for higher income individuals receiving these benefits. I might say that my opponent's theory of privatizing Social Security is disastrous. It doesn't work out on an accounting basis.
Just to sort of cut to the chase, Senior, your questionnaire indicates that you would support means testing. Yes, no?
That's what I'm talking about. That when it's Oberweis and Durbin receiving Social Security checks, that we should have means testing as to COLAs.
Senator. Are you asking about means testing? What's your question?
Go ahead.
Yes. I think that that's something that could be considered. I haven't really thought about that a whole lot. I've thought about other alternatives to that, but so clearly...
That's a pretty weak response. This gentleman just said he's for means testing. You for it or against it?
I think his comment about means testing COLAs, which is going to be a fairly small part of the solution, might make sense, but it isn't going to solve a lot of our problem.
Let me also add, raising the Medicare eligibility age to 67, you ought to meet the people who are counting the days until they qualify for Medicare, who otherwise couldn't get affordable health insurance. The idea of adding two more years of vulnerability to these people...
Under the Affordable Care Act, they can't get
affordable
insurance?
Some can, but ultimately, under Medicare, people, frankly, can't afford otherwise, have an opportunity with Medicare, having paid in their whole lives, and now he wants to leave two more years of vulnerability before they qualify for Medicare.
Senator, if they can't afford it, aren't they eligible for Medicaid?
Well, they could be, but what I'm saying to you
is...
They can
afford it or they can't afford it. If they can't afford it, they must be eligible for Medicaid.
When you get out and move around and talk to some of these people, Jim, you'll get a better idea of what I'm talking about here.
Senator, I've been who has been out talking to people. Yeah. I've been on the south side of Chicago listening to the problems and spending a great deal of time there. They tell me they've never seen you. You haven't been in their community.
Well, I'm sure they welcome you, and they're also
looking
for the first Oberweis ice cream store in the south side of Chicago.
Oh, I'd like to change the channel here. I'm Senator... And you mentioned the immigration bill that you helped write, and in the primary, you told us you would not have voted for that bill. In any case, it passed, it went to the House, totally ignored. House hasn't done anything ever since then. So now the president says he is going to, through executive action, take steps to fix the immigration system, but not until after the election. So my question to you, Senator Durbin, is have you encouraged him to do this? You think this is something he should do? And if so, how far do you think he should go?
There's a transfer facility in Broadview, and you ought to go out and take a look on Friday mornings. There are a couple nuns, wonderful ladies, who get up there at 7:30 every morning, pray the rosary, and stand around to counsel the folks that are about to be deported. I've gone inside there. I even went inside with the director of the Office of Homeland Security. Folks who are about to be deported. Some of them should be deported. They have committed crimes. No ifs, ands, or buts. They should be gone. Others have been swept up. We are breaking up families that have been here a long time. And the people remaining are just heartbroken and don't know where they're going to turn next. Let's fix this immigration system overall. Until it is fixed, let's be thoughtful in deportations. Let's not break up families when they've been here for long periods of time. Let's try to make sure that we apply the law in a thoughtful, sensible way to keep America safe, but not to destroy these families.
So you're not really answering my question. What do you think the president should do?
That's what I said. When it comes to the deportation standards, I have encouraged the president to make sure that we don't deport all those swept up in the dragnet, but only those who are truly a danger to us. And I think many of these folks are not. They are technically in violation of the immigration law. They've never done anything wrong. I honestly believe that they should be brought into the system as our bill would, register with the government, pay their taxes, and be part of our economy. But until then, I think the deportation standard should be changed.
Similar to the deferred action for children?
And I was the first to write to the president for that, and I think it's a good idea. But what we said was, if you're going to qualify for the DREAM Act, we're not going to deport you. Currently 600,000 across the nation have signed up for DACA. Illinois is, I think, third or fourth in the nation of applicants. I've met them. These are great young people who have, they only know this country. They've only been aware of this country. They can make a real contribution to this country. Deporting them would be a tragedy.
Should the president act alone?
I wish he didn't have to, John. Well, I mean,
but evidently that's
the yeah, and should he may be forced to. He may be forced to. He's tried. He waited on Speaker Boehner for month after month.
That sounds like a yes.
It is a yes. If we
so
can't
then
get,
was he smart to, politically smart to hold off
the problem,
after the election?
I wish he could have and did move earlier. I understood the political circumstances. Do you know what
it was purely a political calculation.
Yeah, but it was
right?
It was a calculation based on reality. The last vote of the Republican-controlled U.S. House of Representatives, before they went into August recess, was to call for the deportation of 2 million eligible Dreamers. And after they voted largely on party lines, they stood up and gave themselves a standing ovation. They were so proud of themselves. That is how poisoned the well is now on the issue of immigration. Some hateful and divisive things have been said about this. And I think the president measured that and said, I'll wait till after the election.
I think executive action in something so important as this would be totally wrong for the country. I think that's part of the problem with Obamacare, is that it was done without one single Republican vote, without some type of compromise and working together to solve those problems. I believe that if voters send me to Washington, I will in fact have an opportunity to try to bring people on the left and the right together to finally solve this problem. The senator's been in Washington for 32 years. He hasn't fixed the problem yet. To think that if we send him back, somehow he's magically going to do it the next time around, isn't that the definition of insanity? I believe that there are reasonable compromises that can be made. I believe that blanket amnesty for people who've broken our laws is wrong because it will encourage more people to break our laws.
Well,
I believe we
not like about
can,
the Senate,
can I just
well,
yes,
it
I
didn't have blanket amnesty. Well, I don't think anybody's talking about blanket amnesty.
Yes, it had blanket amnesty
no,
in there
no.
because
no,
everybody
no,
could effectively be brought in and made a citizen. I believe that people ought to apply for citizenship just like anybody else. They should not be moved to the head of the line. They shouldn't get a special deal if they pay a fine or anything of that nature. They ought to have the same legal requirements that anybody who hasn't broken our law. Now, if our laws are wrong, if we don't have the right immigration policy, let's go back and debate that and let's change that. But then let's follow our law, whatever that law happens to be.
Should we deport the
Dreamers? I believe that if kids have grown up here, they were brought here by their parents at a young age, they consider America to be their home country. No, I believe we should not. I believe we should give them a path to citizenship. However, the parents who broke the law, I think it's different. They did it knowingly as parents. They should apply for citizenship just like anybody else and go to the back of the line. Because if they go to the
so
front of the line,
they're divide the families to.
Well, I've also offered a solution to that, and that is to provide those parents so that you don't break up the family with a non-immigrant visa, but not automatic government entitlements. Government entitlements would be a huge additional burden on our current taxpayers. They should, again, not get that benefit by having broken our laws.
You've apologized for your initial political approach on immigration issues. How has your thinking changed? And why did you apologize?
Because I think it did not communicate the right message. My message has always been, we have immigration laws, we cannot reward people who break those laws, and if the law is wrong, let's change the law. That wasn't the message that came across. The ad was not well done. That message, I think, is still true. The one area I have changed on is I do believe if kids have grown up here, they should be given a path to citizenship, because in this country, we don't punish kids for mistakes or errors of their parents.
Three cheers for my opponent. I introduced the DREAM Act 13 years ago, and I'm glad he's supporting it. And if more Republicans would take that position, we could pass it. But let me clarify one thing. There is no blanket amnesty in this law. If you happen to be in the United States undocumented, here's what the Comprehensive Immigration Reform Bill says. You ought to read it. Here's what it says. You have to come forward and register with the government. The government will then do a background check on you. If you've committed a serious crime, you're gone. You don't have any future in this country. But if you have a clear criminal record, you're registered with the government, get ready to pay a fine, a substantial fine, and then get ready to pay your taxes, and then learn English. And at the end of 10 years going through this, virtually qualifying for no government benefits during that period of time, you can then apply for a green card and go to the back of the line. The earliest that these people can become citizens is 13 years. To call this blanket amnesty is really to trivialize a very important policy issue.
So, Senator, could a billion other people in other countries who would like to come here pay that fine and immediately move to there to get a green card?
Jim, if you'd read the bill, it said that the cutoff date was 2 years before the passage of the bill in the Senate. See, read it. And when you read it, you realize there's a cutoff date. Meanwhile...
And what about the people who come after that? Will there be a new amnesty bill that will follow up?
Meanwhile...
5 years from now, 10 years from now.
Meanwhile, what John McCain and your fellow Republicans insisted on was more border security than ever in our history. The border security right now in America between the United States and Mexico, that commitment of federal law enforcement is greater than the combined total of all law enforcement of all other federal agencies, and we doubled it in the bill. We're going to have these people holding hands at the border, our federal law enforcement officials. So there'll be plenty of policing when it comes to the border. That's been an important part of this from the start.
Let me ask a question going back on taxes, corporate inversions, and the idea of companies moving their headquarters overseas, partly for tax reasons. Senator, you're smiling as if you know the question. You are not just a critic, you are an outspoken critic, and you use some very strong language, including accusing these companies of basically being deserters, of being unpatriotic for following the law to follow their own fiduciary responsibility. It's a global economy. These companies are competing worldwide. Isn't this about tax reform? Why are you making it about tax inversion? Why such a strong perspective? And Senator, please let your view.
When corporations don't pay their fair share of taxes, other companies have to pay more and individuals have to pay more. That's the bottom line. And what these companies are trying to do is to avoid tax responsibility. And they've told me as much. I've talked to the CEO of AbbVie. I've talked to the CEO of Walgreens. We all know that. I know what's at stake here. In come these investors from Wall Street who are looking for the stock price to get pumped up enough, some so they can make a killing and get out. I think it is short-sighted for their companies and short-sighted for our nation. Take a look at a pharmaceutical company. How does a pharmaceutical company make money? Well, they develop a drug. Who did the research on the drug in most cases? Taxpayer-supported National Institutes of Health. Then the drug has to be tested to be safe. Who does that? Taxpayer-supported Food and Drug Administration. Then their lawyers have to protect their patent. Who does that? Taxpayer-supported U.S. Patent Office. So here's a pharmaceutical company that has made its fortune taking the benefits from our government-supported, taxpayer-supported institutions and saying, now we're leaving. We're taking these profits and leaving, and we're passing on tax liability to someone else. When Walgreens made that decision, it was a terrible decision. People came up to me in the street. Every walk of life said, I'll never set foot in Walgreens again if they pick up and leave this country. I said to Greg Wasson, you made the right decision to stay. It may hurt your stock initially, but in the long term, you want to be America's pharmacy, stay with America. Now, tax reform. Can I say one word on tax reform?
Nope. We'll come back.
Okay.
Look, the companies have been following the tax code that Senator Durbin helped get passed, and he's had 32 years to try to reform it, try to improve it, try to make us more competitive. Certainly that has not been happening. And then he questioned the patriotism. Nobody in this room or anywhere in the state of Illinois is more concerned about wanting to keep companies in Illinois and keep companies in the United States. That's been my whole background. But he's questioned the patriotism of companies that are following his laws and his tax code. And I want to read to you something that he said here in this room 6 years ago. I'm going to question a lot of things about my opponent, his positions. I will never question your patriotism. I think that is the refuge of scoundrels. I think what you have done here to raise a question as to whether I love this country is the lowest form of politics, the lowest. So, Senator, are you still good with your words that's
I don't question. I don't question your patriotism.
Not mine. How about Walgreens? Do you question Walgreens' patriotism?
Now,
question other countries who are following your tax code that you've been a part of keeping. Instead of doing the right thing and going back for tax reform to simplify this, to make this a country where companies want to be here, once again, you're bullying companies, trying to make them stay here, instead of doing the right thing to have a competitive worldwide tax code that will make sense for those companies.
I don't know if... Becky Verack is in the room? One of your writers?
No.
No? You ought to read this article she wrote in the Chicago Tribune about what corporations actually pay in their corporate income tax rates. It is, you know, we talk about 35%. Very few get anywhere near 35%.
It hasn't been fixed yet.
Here's what, okay,
let me tell. Dave introduces a bill in the House, and the Republicans run for the hills as well.
So let me explain to you why it hasn't been fixed. When my opponent runs for office, at least twice now, maybe more, he makes this hat-in-hand pilgrimage to Washington to walk into the office of Grover Norquist. He's announced this, and to sign the Grover Norquist tax pledge. Do you know what it says?
Yes. We don't like the tax pledge. I'm asking you, being in the majority party in the Senate and being there for so long, where's your tax pledge?
I'm going to refer to the F word again, filibusters. Filibusters. It takes 60 votes. When we have senators who have taken the Grover Norquist tax pledge, they have pledged that they will never reduce any deduction or credit in the tax code. You cannot write tax code reform with that premise. He's gone and made this announcement, signed another oath to Grover Norquist.
Do you support the use of the nuclear option? Do you believe that we shouldn't allow, shouldn't require 60 senators? Do you want to end filibusters?
I will tell you, they are being abused, and you ought to know that. But
do you
I will go back to stop it? Of course not. But it should be limited to those cases where it's rare and it's necessary on big policy items. I favor tax code reform. When's the last time we had it? Last time we had it was 30 years ago. A fellow named Rostenkowski headed it up in the House Ways and Means Committee. It is a tough, tough job. Made doubly tough if you have a split in the parties between the House and the Senate. Made nearly impossible when you have people signing the Grover Norquist tax pledge. If we're going to sit down and look at this tax code, and I favor tax code reform, let's put everything on the table.
You've done a very effective job of this already, but I do want to give you each one opportunity to ask a question of each other. Senator, if you'd like to go first.
I'd like to ask my opponent. You said that you think the Republican Party of Illinois should become the Tea Party. You've been to their rallies. You've accepted their endorsement. And when I look at the Tea Party in Washington, I don't see the Republican Party that I've known. The Tea Party in Washington opposes federal highway construction. I'm not making that up. They not only want to eliminate the mass transit subsidy, they want to get the federal government out of the business of federal highway construction. 75% of the highway construction in our state comes through the federal government sending funds. The Tea Party opposes it.
Is there a question here?
There is, coming right to this question. They also oppose reauthorizing the Ex-Im Bank, critical for businesses like Boeing and smaller businesses. So do you support the Tea Party positions that would cost us jobs here in Illinois?
Senator, I'm not a Tea Party member. I don't know where you got what you started with again. You tend to throw these things out as though they're factual when in many cases they are not. My understanding of the Tea Party is this is a group of individuals who have not been politically involved in the past, who've gotten very concerned about the direction that you have been taking this country, and they would like to change that direction. They believe in limited government, they believe in lower taxes, and those are the main directions that that they would like to see the country go. So I don't know what more I can say.
On the whole, do you think the Tea Party has been a positive or negative influence on the country?
I think they've called attention to the fact that government has gotten too big, that we've got too many regulations.
I know it's too called attention. Generally positive or generally negative?
I think generally positive.
Your turn for a question.
Okay. Senator, during this campaign, we've noted that you and a few other Democrat senators played an integral role in targeting conservative Americans' free speech rights by asking the IRS to investigate them. In addition to the infamous October 10th, 2010 letter asking the IRS to investigate conservative Crossroads Organization, we've asked several times for you to reveal any other communications you or your office have had with the IRS during the midst of the scandal. You have mostly refused to answer this question, but your campaign sent out a statement recently that included the following assertion, quote, Senator Durbin has posted all communications he had with the IRS on his Senate website, and it has been there for 4 years. Do you stand by your campaign's assertion that you and your office had only that one communication with the IRS during the scandal?
Yes.
Let me refute that because
I will give you a copy right here
of correspondence between you and the commissioner of the IRS. This was revealed, it was deep in, but it is available. We'll make it available to the Tribune. You've just obviously not told the truth there, so we'd like to know what else is available. We'd like to ask you to go back to your records. Unfortunately, under FOIA, we can't require you to make those public, but we've asked you to make those public, and you have so far refused to do so. I hope you will change that position.
In that letter and today, I made it clear where I stand on this, why I did it, and why I believe that whether your organization's Democrat, Republican, right, left, liberal, or conservative, we should not
be
protected.
Why again are you not truthful right now in talking about what you have been communicating with the IRS?
Jim, please let me finish. My position is clear, and I disclosed this letter publicly. I wasn't hiding a thing, and I won't hide anything on this issue, and my position hasn't changed. I do have to tell you that you've forgotten, the Daily Herald hasn't, on April 16, 2014, in addressing a local Tea Party meeting, Oberweis said, take over the Illinois Republican Party.
Sure, and let me explain what that was about. People were asking how they can get involved, and does the Republican Party welcome them? I said, yes, it welcomes them. Welcomes you. If you want to be more involved, come in, get elected, become members of the Republican Party.
You asked an IRS question. Are you satisfied with the answer?
Well, I'm satisfied that he did not tell the truth, once again. And we'd like him to now tell the truth.
My position
is own up to the fact that he has had other correspondence, and we'd like to know what additional correspondence he's had with the IRS.
I've made public the letter that we sent to the IRS for 4 years.
But why did you just lie about it?
I will tell you this. You walk out on the streets of Chicago.
Stop lying. Tell the truth, for heaven's sakes.
You walk out
on the streets. Give us the rest of the correspondence you've had with the IRS.
You walk out on the streets of Chicago and ask the first 100 people how many of them think the senator from Illinois ought to be focused on protecting Karl Rove and the Crossroads PAC. Only one that I know.
Is there more correspondence?
No, not that I know of. Not anything.
Not that you know.
I've given everything that I think I have. We'll double check. If there's anything else, it'll be disclosed.
We want to be respectful of your time. Catherine, anything else?
I would like, you both gentlemen have led long, full, rich lives. There's more to come. Tell us what you'd like printed on your tombstone to summarize what it was all about.
I plan on being cremated. I don't want any monuments.
If you had a tombstone.
Pardon me?
What would you like your legacy to be in a nutshell?
He was honest and he helped the helpless. Those are the two things Paul Simon said to me about public service. I've never heard a better description of what a public servant's job should be.
Senator Oberweis?
Here lies Jim Oberweis, a man who cared about his family, who cared about his country, who cared about his state, and who cared about the people most in need.
Senator Sankey, it's been a great conversation. We really appreciate you taking time with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, Senator. Yes.